APRS, buying used gear, and those illegal Baofeng radios. We're going to talk about all that and more on the next Your Questions Answered. So please stick around for more. Hi, I'm Michael, KV9GBR, your host for Ham Radio Q&A. I'm on a mission to inspire and educate the amateur radio community, so if this is your first time watching, please consider hitting that subscribe button. Well, we've had a lot of new subscribers as of late, so for the benefit of everyone, about once a month, I crawl through all of those questions and comments, pick out the best ones, and highlight them in a Your Questions Answered episode of Ham Radio Q&A. So thanks for leaving those behind. But boy, do we have some great questions this month. We're going to dig a little bit into APRS, also a great comment on buying used stuff, and of course those illegal Baofeng radios. We've got a lot of heated comments on those. But first, let's dig into APRS. So one of the questions I received was a great one about digipeaters, but two questions. What is the difference between low and high level digipeats? And also, why do you need two wide statements in the path, like Wide1-1 and Wide2-2? Couldn't you just use a Wide3-3? Well, there's two different thoughts on digipeaters. Some people believe that you should have really high digipeaters that cover a vast amount of territory to give you the most bang for the buck. And then other people believe that several low-level digipeaters are better because more low-level digipeaters actually reduce overall network congestion instead of few wide digipeaters carrying the load for everybody. Really, the best kind of network configuration for APRS is to have a combination of low-level and high-level digipeaters. The low-level digipeaters take care of the fill in the holes and the gaps, and the wide area ones are the backhaul to increase your range and territory in the APRS network. So low-level digipeaters, if they're properly configured, are going to only digipete packets that have a path of Wide1-1. So if you're a mobile station, you're going to want to have a Wide1-1 in your path so that you can hit a low digipeater and get carried on to the network, where a high or a wide digipeter will then take that 2-2 and throw it two more hops further. Of course, wide digipeters are also going to listen for a Wide1-1. So if you get picked up by a low and a wide, your packet's going to go conceivably by both of those digipeaters. Home stations, they almost never should use the Wide1-1 protocol. And the reason is that home stations should be able to be heard by a wide digi on their own. You're going to want to listen around on the APRS network for, you know, maybe an hour or so to see how many wide digis that you can hear directly from your location. And then use just a wide 2-2 as your only path, or a wide 3-3 if you want to go out three hops if you're in a non-congested area. Or do a named digipeater, like a W9SM-1, that's my local digipeater, and then a comma wide 2-2. That's going to be the most efficient route, is to use your name digipeater, comma wide 2-2. Takes you out three hops, and it alleviates that local level congestion because you're naming a particular digi to have your packets retransmitted on. Moving on with APRS, hey Michael, great video. I'm going to be teaching a technician class at my work, and I'd love to show your video when talking about APRS. I really appreciate all the work you do. 73s from N7CPM. Thanks for the testimony there. I really appreciate the fact that you love the videos. But all of my videos can be freely used for educational purposes, so feel free to use them for classes, training sessions, club meetings. The content is really designed for those types of purposes. In fact, you know, if you're going to use them for a technician class, I do try to mirror a lot of the content in the that you may find in the technician question pool. So many of the videos will be appropriate for studying your technician like Sam. If you're teaching a class, I'd recommend you also check out my video on HF transceiver controls. A little link up here will get you to that. That one is also mirrors many of the questions on the technician exam when it comes to using HF transceivers and what the features and functions are, geared right there towards the exam. For my video, Buying Used Ham Radio Equipment, I received this question. Well, the problem is that people are selling used equipment, want brand new prices. I've been to many websites and ham radios that are 8 years old or even 4 years old, you know, these guys are asking brand new retail prices for them. If the ham community wants new hams to come on board, they need to stop trying to rip people off. I understand they might be attached to the item, but asking brand new prices for a unit that's 48 years old, come on. Well, that's a common complaint I heard. And I've, in my personal experience too, I've seen a lot of gently used HF gear going for close to retail prices. It seems like ham radio equipment has kept its value very well. And our low inflation we've seen in the last decade really hasn't helped in that regard either. There's not to say that there's not a lot of good values out there, and maybe you just need to set your sights a little bit further back. There's a lot of great transceivers from even the late 80s and the 90s into the very early 2000s that are quite serviceable and are excellent values. In fact, I was just strolling through a ham fest a couple weeks ago and saw some great prices on transceivers. We're in that 15 to 25 year age category. So they may not have the whiz-bang computerized features and digital signal processing, but I guarantee these 90s era transceivers have excellent receive, some great mechanical filtering in them, and they are very serviceable. And if you're looking to get started in HF, I would highly recommend going that route. A couple of tips, you know, if you're going to be purchasing a used transceiver is, you know, number one, first, you know, don't be afraid to do a little bit of research. If you find a used unit and you're not sure about the price, you know, maybe walk away from the table, take out your phone, search eBay, search online to see what the retail or what the used street price is for that item. And that'll kind of give you an idea if the person asking their price is high or low, and you can kind of make an offer based on that. And the second thing too is that maybe make your offers later in the morning. If you're at a ham fest and it looks like people are starting to pack up, that's kind of the really good time to go in, and don't be afraid to make an offer. Maybe go a little bit lower than what you would think and meet in the middle to something that's good. You know, it's when people are ready to go, they're more likely to negotiate on the price than it is first thing in the morning. So kind of keep that in mind when you're searching used. And finally, if you're not really experienced in some of these older pieces of equipment, you know, bring another ham with you, one that's used some of this gear, and they'll give you a lot of tips on transceivers to look at, things to avoid, and prices that he thinks, you know, that's a good deal, or that's kind of a little bit on the high side. I hope that helps you out, and maybe at your next ham fest you can find something that's affordable and meets your needs. All right, now we're going to get into that big elephant that's in the room. So back a couple of months ago, I did a video on the Baofeng radios. Are they now illegal? It was a response to the FCC's citation and order to APRS Industries. They're an importer of the Baofeng UV5R radios. And it's an issue that the FCC's been dealing with for APRS for years and years and years. And it finally took this summer for them to issue a citation to tell them to stop marketing this their particular UV5R because it had a Part 90 type acceptance, but it was not a Part 90 type accepted radio. Well, you can imagine the comments I received on this video, time went by, and now about 2 weeks ago, the FCC put out another public notice on which was actually an enforcement advisory concerning Baofeng handhelds. And in the wake of that, I received this one comment that kind of highlighted, you know, was the best description of all of the previous comments that I received previously. So at the time the video was published, this might have been the case, but on September 28th, well, actually the 24th, the FCC issued Enforcement Advisory DA 18-890. That changes the situation. It is, if that Baofeng radio of yours is capable of transmitting on, say, part 90 or the GMRS, as the one I have is, this is the commenter says that, and it does not possess certification for those services, then it is illegal to use at all, even on the amateur bands. Well, the FCC advisory certainly is a line they put in the sand, putting users of Baofeng radios on notice that their radios may not be compliant for amateur radio use in the United States. A link to the public notice, you'll find that in the video description below, so you can read it on your own. In the public notice, the FCC states that in order for a radio to be usable in the U.S., it needs one of two things. First, it has to be either certified or for an intended radio service, like Part 90, the land mobile service, or Part 95, the personal radio services. Or if it is not certified for any radio service, then it can be used on the amateur radio service, but only if it is only capable of transmitting on the amateur radio bands and nothing else. But if the radio is certified for another radio service, it can also be used on the amateur radio bands. Effectively, the FCC has said that effectively all Baofeng radios and their variants are not suitable for use in the United States because they don't carry that Part 90 type acceptance, nor are they only limited to the amateur radio bands in operation. But the story isn't over, and now the ARRL has gotten into the fray. The league is in discussion with the FCC over this very issue, and in an article that they posted on their website, links below, of course, the key takeaway of their statement is, it is important to protect the flexibility of amateur radio service as essentially an experimental radio service. And that's a very important piece to remember, because over a century, the amateur radio service has had precedent, and also the spirit of ham radio is to build your own equipment, is to modify commercial equipment, and it's an experimental radio service. So as long as the equipment meets the particular emission standards that are put forth in Part 97, that equipment should be able to be used on the amateur radio service, regardless if it's type accepted on another radio service or not. My personal opinion is, I think we're going to see a bit of backpedaling on the FCC. I wouldn't be surprised if they're going to come out with some kind of clarifications or modifications to that public notice, giving a more clear exception of this equipment for amateur radio use. Because as it stands now, if the FCC were to enforce the rules as interpreted in this enforcement advisory, vast amounts of commercial radio gear would not be suitable for use on the amateur radio service. Nor would they be able to enforce the rules, because literally there are millions of Baofeng radios in daily use in the U.S. It would be an impossible task. They let that genie out of the bottle years ago when the radio started coming into this country, and they didn't do anything about it. So, well, that's it for this month. Have a question or comment, please leave it in the comments below. Keep watching. We're going to have some great videos coming up in the next few weeks. A couple more APRS videos are planned. I got a great HamFest find that I'm going to highlight, and also there might be even a product review in there. If you've got a topic or a suggestion for a future video, leave them in the comments. I'll add it to the list. And as always, more articles and information can be found in my blog over at www.jpol-antenna.com. If you enjoyed this video, give me a big thumbs up. I really appreciate that. Check out some of the other videos that are suggested over here. And also, don't forget to hit that subscribe button if you haven't already done so. That's so you'll be notified when future videos are released. Well, I'm Michael, KB9VBR. Have a great day, 73, and thanks for watching.